Funding for this firing line debate is made possible by grants from the John M. Olin Foundation, the Annenberg Foundation, the Hatton W. Sumners Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation.
Good evening. From Texas Christian University in Fort Worth, welcome to a special firing line debate. I'm the moderator. My name's Mike Kinsley, and I'm the editor of Slate Online Magazine. But on firing line, I'm just the tool of larger forces, otherwise known as William F. Buckley, Jr. Mr. Buckley always frames these debates so that his side is the affirmative. Fair enough, it's his show. But tonight, he's outdone himself. Our topic is resolved. Government should not discriminate against private schools. Now, who could be against that? In fact, tonight's topic is school vouchers. The idea is, instead of the public school system funded and operated directly by the government should give parents vouchers worth a certain amount of money. Parents could then use the vouchers to pay for a child's education at the school of their choice, public or private. Voucher enthusiasts believe that parents should have greater choice about how their children are educated. They say it's unfair that affluent parents can send their kids to private school, but poor parents can't. And they predict that competition will improve the quality of all schools. Opponents think vouchers will destroy America's system of universal public education. They worry about the government subsidizing religious and other special interest schools. And they believe that parents who want to send their kids to private school ought to pay for it themselves. Does government funding of public school systems amount to discrimination against private schools? To me, that's like saying that when the government builds public highways, it's discriminating against private roads. But what do I know? I'm only the moderator. Let's bring on the debaters and let them hash this thing out. Please help me welcome them now. Captain of the affirmative team is captain of this whole enterprise, William F. Buckley, Jr. Besides founding National Review, writing umpteen books and umpteen thousand newspaper columns, playing the harpsichord, sailing hither and thither, et cetera, et cetera, Mr. Buckley has been the host and star of Firing Line on public television for 26 years. In other words, the government has been subsidizing Mr. Buckley for over a quarter century. Now, does that amount to discrimination against lesser pundits? Speaking on behalf of lesser pundits, I think we need a system of government-funded pundit vouchers, which we can use to buy TV time to compete with Mr. Buckley. Pete DuPont is the former governor of Delaware and former Republican presidential candidate. These days, he's policy chairman of the National Center for Policy Analysis, an editor of an online magazine called Intellectual Capital. Now, PBS tells us we're not supposed to give web addresses on the air, but if you type Intellectual Capital into your browser, you might be pleasantly surprised. The same goes for Slate, by the way. Jimmy Mansour is a Texas-based entrepreneur who has founded two long-distance telephone companies, one in Texas and one in Florida. He's active in Catholic religious affairs and is vice president of the Austin Children's Educational Opportunity Foundation. Brother Bob Smith is a member of the Franciscan Order in Milwaukee, where he is principal and president of Mesmer High School. He also teaches at the University of Wisconsin. Opposition team, be forewarned. Brother Bob is not only a master-level basketball official, he is also an expert in the martial arts. I guess there'll be no turning over the other cheek from Brother Bob tonight. Over on the opposition team, the captain is Bill Curry. Mr. Curry, a Democrat, is currently making his second run for governor of Connecticut, a race he narrowly lost in 1994. He's also a fellow at the Yale School of Management. In 1995 and 96, he was a senior domestic policy advisor to President Clinton, specializing in education, among other matters. If Mr. Curry becomes a governor, he has promised to make Mr. Buckley's house in Sharon a state park. Mr. Buckley will be compensated, of course, in vouchers. Ira Glasser is executive director of the American Civil Liberties Union and a well-known firing line host, guest, and debater, and a regular William F. Buckley sparring partner. Although Mr. Glasser opposes school vouchers, he supports a system of free speech vouchers, which would guarantee every citizen an equal opportunity to get in a word in edgewise while debating William F. Buckley. Actually, Mr. Glasser, as you'll see, does pretty well at that even without vouchers. Christopher Edley is a professor at Harvard Law School and author of a forthcoming book on affirmative action called Not All Black and White. He served in the Jimmy Carter administration as assistant director of the Office of Management and Budget, and he served for 2.5 years in the Clinton administration as associate director of the Office of Management and Budget. If he doesn't become director of that office in the next administration as a Democrat, he plans to become a Republican and start back at the beginning. Bob Chase is president of the National Education Association, a post he was elected to last year. Mr. Chase has been a classroom teacher since 1965. The NEA, representing teachers, has become one of the largest and most influential unions in America. There are those who think that the NEA is too influential, though Mr. Chase, I believe, is not one of them. We have 2 hours tonight, and we thought of distributing vouchers to each team and let them use their time as they saw fit, according to free market principles. But in the end, we stuck to the old top-down bureaucratic rules. Under those rules, Mr. Buckley, you now have 3 minutes to make your opening statement. Mr. Buckley.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, we have arrived in education policy at the grotesque irony. American liberals, so widely identified with a concern for the needy, with the importance of learning and training, have turned their backs on the urban poor. Why? For 2 reasons. One of them, the tribal attractions of monopoly exploitation. I speak, of course, of the teachers' unions. I say exploitation because the teachers' bureaucracies grow in numbers, in expense, while student levels of achievement diminish. And for the second reason, which is the ideological fixation on church-state, I say ideological, because of the threat to America of an establishment of religion, is roughly as realistic as the threat of an invasion from Mars. So we are here today to plead at Texas Christian University that we be instructed by the great experiment of 50 years ago. I invite our adversaries to criticize if they promise to give the reasons for doing so. The GI Bill of Rights, which permitted the veteran to select whichever school he sought to pursue his studies, the expense underwritten as a return by the people of the United States of some part of the wages and advantages forfeited when young men interrupted their careers to fight for their country. There was nobody there standing with a shotgun in front of Fordham University or the Jewish Theological Seminary insisting that no student armed with public money could enter on the grounds that Fordham teachers don't belong to the union, or on the grounds that James Madison feared that the Jews would impose their religion on fellow Americans. No, they are silent, our friends here, on the Bill of Rights, but insist that the privileges given to 20-year-old American veterans must not be given to 10-year-old children in Milwaukee or in Cleveland. So rigid is their fixation on a fanatical interpretation of the First Amendment that a privilege inures that does not seem to violate the proper balance or freedoms secured in Sweden, Germany, France, Denmark, or Belgium. The data appear to have no effect at all on their thinking. The average church-related school spends $3,000 per year per student. The average public school more than twice that much, and with results in urban centers disastrously bad. In Chicago, an illustration, 40% of all students attend Catholic schools. How many non-teaching administrative jobs are required to do this? 36. You would then expect that the public schools would have, by this standard, half again as many administrators, or 54. You would be wrong. The public schools in Chicago have 3,300 administrators. You would think, would we not, that liberal forces in America would seek to extend to poor parents the liberty to choose a school for their children? You would be wrong. Professor Caroline Hawksby of Harvard gives us some idea of the consequences of this rigidity. A $1,000 voucher would improve performance across the board. She says both public and private school children would increase the amount of time spent in school by about 2 years. Math and reading test scores would improve by about 10%, and the future value of student income would rise by 14%. In his State of the Union address, Mr. Clinton tossed into the pot every benefit he could think of to advance educational opportunity, except the one he gave to his daughter Chelsea, which was access to a private school. We think Chelsea is terrific. She is off to a first-rate college, and she is not scheming with anybody we know of to put the Pope in the White House or to close down the public schools. Mr. Chairman, on the resolution, the government should not discriminate against private schools. Could the affirmative put in with you for a directed verdict?
You can. Motion denied, Mr. Buckley. Mr. Curry, opening statement for the opposition.
First of all, I don't think that anyone on our side of this debate, or on any side of this debate as it goes on across the country, is going to argue that there aren't many things broken about education in this country that need fixing. But I think the very first thing that needs to be said is that, in part, this entire discussion represents a kind of denial about the root causes of educational performance problems in the United States. Show me a school system where all the parents are in the top percentile of income, and I'll show you a bunch of kids who, by and large, are on their way to Harvard. Show me a school system whose parents are in the bottom percentile of income, and I'll show you a bunch of kids on their way to jail. And for us not to understand at the outset that there are profound issues of the stratification of class and race in this country that have affected the performance of children, the changes in the explosion of a drug culture, the breakdown of family, the rise in criminal violence. All of these things, I would argue, are first and foremost at the heart of this problem. A public school classroom is a window through which we see problems that arise in other places. Much of this entire debate, not simply over vouchers, but much of the debate over public education reform is a kind of rearranging of the deck chairs on the Titanic, when it's not the public school system but the society itself that's the boat. And so the first thing we need to do in order to have an intelligent discussion of how to move this country forward is to recognize the root causes, as we have resisted recognizing the root causes of what ails us. The second thing we need to do is to recognize that there is a problem within education itself. But the solution proposed here, and I think that it probably represents Mr. Buckley's only flirtation with creeping socialism in an entire lifetime. He wishes to extend the public purse, and I assume, having heard him argue so many times previously, that this always extends some form of public regulation, that this always involves some expansion of the public sector in our lives, that the way to do this is to, in a sense, extend the dollars of taxpayers into the private sector. The first thing we have to understand is that there are about 5 million children in private education right now in this country. If we were to simply offer vouchers at about half the rate of the cost of public education, or the full rate that you, for the sake of argument, cited in your own opening remarks, This would be more than the entire federal subsidy of public education today in the United States of America. Someone has to own up to the fact that this money would come from existing budgets or require the kind of massive tax increase that you have at every turn fought so hard in this country's history to stop. Someone has to take a look at whether or not there are other things that really would go to the heart of what's wrong with public education that might get done that won't be done if this is the path that we walk. This is not an abandonment of the disadvantaged children in our cities and impoverished small towns across this country. I think that the most enthusiastic supporter of your position wouldn't ever guess that you could more than double or triple the next generation the number of children who were involved in private education in this country. And of the 70% who were left behind, what's to be said for them? In a public education system that struggles to maintain majoritarian support within this country for its sustenance, what is the likely impact on all the children, not just whose parents won't choose private schools, but who won't themselves be chosen by private schools for admission? In many ways, what's on the table here is nothing less than the death knell of the melting pot, an abandonment of the very notion of common ground, of common schools, of equal opportunity, which is at the heart of the promise of America.
Thank you, Mr. Curry. Mr. Glasser and Governor DuPont. Governor DuPont, this is your chance to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to leave four thoughts in your mind as you listen to the other speakers this evening on the question of school choice. Allowing a parent to choose the school that their child is going to go to makes sense for these four reasons. First, it's a question of fairness. All families ought to have access for their children to the schools that today only the wealthiest families have access to. Secondly, giving parents this choice empowers them to do the best thing for their children. And isn't that what America's about? Trying to do the best thing for your kids. Thirdly, if parents could choose the schools their children go to, there would be a sense of ownership in those schools, a sense of participation, a sense of belonging, and the quality of all the schools that are chosen would begin to rise. And finally, and perhaps most important, allowing parents to choose schools for their children would be just. It is not just to compel children to go to lousy schools. It is not just not to give parents the chance to do the best thing for their children. It's not just to trap kids in schools that really ought not to be called schools at all.
Thank you, Governor DuPont. Mr. Glasser.
Well, Mr. DuPont has his principles right, but his facts all wrong. Mr. Buckley and I guess Mr. DuPont, who have not made their reputations by fighting for the urban poor, now come to accuse liberals of abandoning the urban poor. Why? Because vouchers, they say, are going to give the poor choices they do not have now. Vouchers, they say, will allow poor parents to purchase the same sort of education which wealthy parents can purchase and will allow them choice. That is false for two reasons. One, if you take the federal bill, for example, the federal bill that was proposed in 1995 provided $3,000 for each child each year. But the median cost of tuition in private schools in this country, the median cost, is $10,300. And if you do not have the other $7,000, you cannot use the $3,000 voucher. So the only way in which parents will be able to use these vouchers is if they can make up the difference. Now, I ask you to imagine a family of two, urban poor, inner city, or even middle class families. Where are they going to come up with $14,000? What's going to happen is that those vouchers will simply be handouts, tax handouts, for people who are already going to private school. It will not give choice to anybody. And moreover, how can it give choice to poor parents, even if they can afford the tuition, when the private schools do not have to take them and retain the choice retain the choice that public schools do not have, which is to take the most difficult children and figure out how to keep them from failing.
Thank you. Governor DuPont, you now have 5 minutes to interrogate Mr. Glasser.
A couple of questions, Mr. Glasser. Secretary of Education Richard Riley, in his annual State of American Education speech, talked in 1994, the first year he gave his speech, of schools that shouldn't be called schools at all. That's his language, awful schools. He talked about them again in 1997. My question to you is, why shouldn't a mother whose daughter is conscripted to go to those schools be allowed to choose a different school if she wants to?
I love that idea, Mr. DuPont, but the voucher system won't do it. We are not talking about what should be. We are talking about your proposals. Your proposals will not achieve that at all. It will not give her choice for two reasons, as I said. One is it will not give her enough money. The government is not saying, you go out to this poor woman, you go out and find what school you want, and just send us the bill. The government is not saying that, nor is the government requiring the school that she chooses to take her child. So where is this choice coming from?
Let me get this straight. You agree with me in the concept. It's just the arithmetic that bothers you.
No, it isn't the arithmetic. It's also the politics.
Ah, so you're mending your first statement just a tad.
Well, you tell me. You tell me where a family of two is going to come up with $14,000.
You're going to
help them out?
First of all, there are 14,000 children today participating with private vouchers in 29 cities around America that are finding not the $14,000 that they need, but the $1,400 they need to make a 50-50 match to go to a parochial school or an independent school.
Most and over 80% of those kids are going to religious schools whose avowed purpose is not to educate those kids, but to propagate their faiths and convert those children.
Oh, come on. Come on, Mr. Glenn.
You don't think so?
Let me ask you a question on that subject.
Ask me a question.
63% of the Catholic Charities budget in the United States of America comes from the government. Is that unconstitutional?
Let me answer that question by reading to you from the mission statement of the schools who are participating in these voucher programs that you described. There's 20 of these. Here's one. We believe our school exists only to carry out the Savior's command to go and make disciples. Consequently, our school's primary reason for existence is to be a tool for bringing young souls to faith in Jesus. A prospective student whose parents are not members of a church, will be considered as mission prospects. Now, that's a fine mission statement, but not with everybody else's tax money.
Well, then how can you explain a college or university in America that has a very similar mission statement to which you're allowed to go using GI Bill money? How can you explain a daycare center in a church that has a mission statement much like that, that is allowed to use federal daycare subsidy funds? It seems you would take the position that it's constitutional when you're under 5 and constitutional when you're over 18 and unconstitutional in the middle.
Most of the time, those programs do not have as a mission, as their primary mission in the classroom, integrated with the curriculum, which is what these statements say, to proselytize and convert children to their faith. And when you're 19 or 20 years old and you're going to college, it's not the same as when you're 5 or you're 6 and you're impressionable. And parents do not want the government to pay with their tax dollars to have their child converted to a faith, not their own.
Could you tell me where that difference?
And that is why every time these things have come up for a referendum vote, they have been voted down by the public by better than 2-1.
Could you tell me where in the Constitution that says the difference between your 5 when you're 5 and you're 18?
Where in the Constitution does it say that?
I don't read the First Amendment as saying it's okay for 18-year-olds and not
read the First Amendment
okay
at all.
For 5.
Well, because what happens is when you're 18, you are an adult. When you're 18, you can be drafted into the Army. When you're 18, you vote. When you're 5 years old, you're impressionable. And if you think that doesn't make a difference, you haven't raised children.
Well, I have raised children.
Well, so then you must know the difference.
And
so why are you asking me?
And they all went to the school that was the best school for them, and I just like to see every mother have that opportunity. But come back to the
Constitution. So would I, but we're talking about whether your proposal does it, and
indeed,
it does not.
It's doing it in 29 cities around the country. It could do it in a great many more if the ACLU would get off of its straw man and let the parents go.
All right, Mr. Glasser, I get to you.
All right, let me ask you a few questions. Let me ask you if, how do you plan to fund, and let's get serious here. These vouchers are $1,400, and the median tuition is $10,300. Places like New York, it's over $12,000, and that famous school in Washington that everybody wants the poor kids to go to, Sidwell, it's over $12,000 a year. Tell me how you plan to have a parent have the choice to go to those schools when they don't have the money to make it up, the voucher is only at best $3,000, and the school doesn't have to take their kid if the kid, say, is learning disabled.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you mentioned learning disabled, and you took a little shot at me on the urban poor earlier. I was governor of a state that has an urban area in it, and one of the things we did for the disabled kids was in our law write a plan for each disabled child in Delaware. And many of those go with state money to private schools because the private schools are better at treating their disability.
Can you point out a single voucher plan now in effect which requires private schools to take kids regardless?
The schools dealing with autistic kids, for example,
I didn't ask you that. I asked you if you can point out a single voucher plan which requires private schools.
No, I don't.
So where is the choice? The choice is in the schools, not in the parents.
That's true.
Yes, and the choice will continue to be in the schools.
The
parents and the kids who need it most will get at least.
The answer to the question about how would it work is that we designed such a plan in our state. The voucher was $2,000. That enabled you to get into every private school in Delaware but for three.
If they would take you.
Oh, indeed, they would take you.
That's really nice to know. Why would they take you? Are they required to take you?
No, they want your business. They want the voucher.
They want the opportunity. They want the students with whom they will succeed.
Well,
if that were not true, they wouldn't be turning away all those kids now. The difference between the public schools and the private schools is the public schools have to take those kids, and the private schools don't have to. Where is the choice?
What is your position on the Cardinals' offer in New York?
I thought this was my turn to ask questions.
Well, it is, but I'm slipping
one
in.
Let me ask you if you're prepared to advocate an increase in taxes in order to pay for this.
You don't need an increase in taxes.
Then where will the money come from?
The money comes from the existing
$6,000.
Yes, and if you give the $3,000 voucher, that moves with the child to the new school, and there is one less child in the old school, and they have about $1,500 more per student to educate the student.
So what you're saying is that the public schools, which are already most impoverished in the areas of the urban poor, will now have their budgets further reduced because you don't want to raise taxes to pay for this harebrained idea. Is that what you're saying?
No. It is an American idea, not a harebrained idea.
Those two are not inconsistent, I'm sorry to say. But go ahead.
I'll rest my case. Go ahead.
Well, I want to also know if you were prepared to follow public money with public accountability. For example, are you prepared to prohibit religious schools that take kids to teach them secular education from propagating their faith if the parents don't want that faith propagated?
Parents are choosing these schools. There are millions of parents across America, I don't know how many millions, but millions of them who believe that a religious component to an education is important, and I would argue that it's unjust to tell them they're not allowed to send their children.
Well, they are allowed. Nobody is saying that.
You just said that.
No. You are very fond of saying things that are unjust, which of course nobody is arguing. Parents have a right to send them now. The question is, if you have a voucher system, and if the voucher that you're providing is not enough money for their kids to go to secular private schools, which it is not, and they are then channeled into religious schools, which they don't want to go to, and those religious schools, by their own admission, have as their primary purpose to proselytize those kids, You tell me, what choice are you giving those poor parents?
They don't have
None
to
at all.
Send their... Absolutely wrong.
And if they don't send their kids to those schools, where do they send them?
You use the word channel. There's a good bureaucratic word. Parents are choosing to go to these schools because they want
because,
to have a
Because
a
you don't want to raise enough
children.
Taxes to give them enough vouchers to have them go to secular schools.
You can go to every private
school. Do you believe in choice? You can't.
In I mean, Delaware, you can go to every private school but three.
If the median is $10,000, where are you going to get the other seven?
Boys and girls, thank you very much. No, not Chris. Not yet. You'll get your chance. Mr. Mansour, this is your chance for an opening statement.
The issue confronting us today, ladies and gentlemen, is much larger than public versus private schools or about volumes of academic data and research. The focus today is who should have the right to choose where your child is educated. Consider other government programs which use forms of vouchers, food stamps, Medicare, Medicaid, Head Start, GI Bill, and Pell Grants. We don't require the recipients to shop at a government grocery store, see a government doctor, attend a government daycare center, or enroll only at a government university. In each of these, the program empowers and entrusts the individual to make their own decisions. Let me share with you a working example of what parental school choice is all about. At the Children's Educational Opportunity Foundation, we assist over 13,000 low-income families by providing a voucher, which enables them to go to the school of their choice. In their new schools, these children, which the system said were uneducatable, were low risk, were high risk, they are realizing success they never dreamed possible. We have over 40,000 families on our wait list. But more importantly, there are millions of children who are stuck in low-income and low-performing schools and unsafe schools and desperately begging for a way out. The question for us today is, will we continue to discriminate against these families by denying them a chance at a better school?
Questions from the opposition team. Captain Curry.
Just as a first question, Mr. Mansour, there's been a fair amount of discussion back and forth about the costs involved here. And your team, you in your own remarks and your team seems to focus on the incremental cost of what it costs to send the very next child to qualify and to sidestep the issue of the 5 million children who are presently enrolled. Is this a proposal that would leave whoever's already gone and sent their child to a private school with no funding, and whoever happened to wait long enough with full funding? It seems to me that if you read the resolution that says that the government shall not discriminate, in this case withhold federal subsidy, I guess is the definition of discrimination, that every parent with a child in private school qualifies. And so that there's at least an initial cost for the system we have in place without adding one child to a private school of anywhere from $12 to $15 billion. Don't you feel some sense of duty to indicate where that money would come from?
Let me correct, Mr. Curry, your math for a minute. In your opening statement, you talked about, with all due respect, the difference in the two costs are public out here at about $6,000 per student per year, private at about $3,000 per student per year.
I used now, Mr. Glasser, for you, though. I used private 3,000 times, if you take $3,000 times 5.5 million children,
sure.
You have a federal subsidy of $12 billion, you're up at over $15
billion sure.
in the cost of this. My question is, that money at $3,000 or at $2,000,
I understand
where does that come from? Where does that $10 to $15 billion come from in this present system? Anywhere?
I understand your question.
Okay.
Real clearly.
I'm just so happy the math worked out.
No, I was questioning the math on your earlier statement. Figure that of the 51 million or so students who are presently enrolled in schools across this country, about 10% of those are private school children. In a system of universal choice, which I think is what your question is related to, let's assume that 20% of those students decide on an alternate school. for one reason or another, a different school. Now, here's a child that we were spending $6,000 on who can go to any number of schools at $3,000. There's a terrific amount of savings to the government there. Now, that's one part of the equation. Then add to that, I think that Mr. Buckley mentioned Hoxby's study. We have seen this in many schools when you have competition, when you engage the secondary school system in a system where they are competing for students, efficiencies do come about. I think it's important to note, and this is really one of the terrific benefits of the system, is Milwaukee School Board member John Gardner. He was opposed to vouchers. Now here it is, 5 years later, and this is what he says about the Milwaukee school system. A system that once treated parents with contempt has begun to answer their calls and embrace local experiments through a charter school or other partnerships with community groups. A system that has been arrogant and indifferent for 20 years has suddenly got religion. This is the type of efficiencies that will come about in a system of public and private schools.
Let me just say that the premise in your math, to go back to my initial question, yes, which I kind of feel you're sidestepping, the idea that overnight 2 to 3 times the present number of private school enrollees are going to be suddenly let into a quality private school alternative seems to me to carry a very heavy burden of proof. There's an upfront big ticket cost to this that seems nowhere in any of your arguments to be acknowledged. We presently have that number, over 5 million children in private education in this country. We are talking about adding, by your numbers, $2,000 to $3,000 a year. It's got to come from somewhere. I come from a state in which we raise more money in property taxes than we do in income and sales tax combined in Connecticut. And the entire cost of education rests upon that local property tax base. And it is straining to sustain itself today. Someone on your team's got to tell the country where the dough comes from.
Well, maybe why it's straining, Mr. Curry, is because in public education, less than 50% of the money, by the time it goes through that maze, actually ends up at classroom instruction. I believe that what will happen... What will happen, the math is fairly easy. If 10 million of the students move over into the private institutions, there's your $3,000 per student savings right away. That is not counting what we're going to realize in efficiencies at the public school level once competition.
Where do you get this $3,000 cost?
Mr. Glasser, we'll have to take that up later. Yeah. We're out of time. Okay. You both get an A in math. Professor Edley. Professor Edley, your chance for an opening statement.
I have 4 questions that I hope the audience will bear in mind as we discuss this issue. The first is, how much will it cost? The second, who will really have the choice? The third, who will be left out, left behind? And the fourth, why are we being offered a choice between privatizing public education for our children on the one hand and schools we don't think are good enough on the other? Why aren't we talking about fixing the schools that we have? Now, on the how much will it cost, the opposition keeps running away from a simple fact. 5 million children in private schools today, all of whom would be eligible for a voucher. At $3,000, that's roughly $15 billion. $15 billion that will go to children who are already in private school. No changes will occur for $15 billion. Where will that money come from? Who will really have the choice? We keep asking this. Poor students, the folks that you claim to care most about, poor folks will not have the money to make up for the difference between the amount of the voucher and the amount of the tuition at the vast majority of private schools. They will not have a choice. The schools will decide who to admit. Let me stop there and answer your questions.
Good, thank you.
Mr. Edney, you were quoted on the McNeil-Lehrer show as agreeing, as all right-minded people know, that generally the public schools in this country are doing a bad and in some places a horrible job. Now, some of your colleagues here from the ACLU and the NEA are against vouchers and choice. My question to you is, in light of that, what are you for that will help those kids dying in public schools tomorrow?
Listen, I think that... I think that there are very serious problems in public education in many parts of this country. I do think that many of the critiques overstate the extent of the problem, because there are many schools that are functioning quite well. My primary concern, like yours, is with those schools that are not functioning well. And I am in favor of radical change in those schools, but not the radical change that would dismantle public education, but instead the steps that are necessary in order to save it. That means that teachers who are doing an effective job need to be supported, encouraged in every way possible, given the resources to do their jobs in communities and societies in which the odds are absolutely against them. It also means the teachers who are not doing their job have to be weeded out. But most importantly, I am in favor of radical, militant, political action in streets and communities around this country to improve public education, but I am not in favor of selling snake oil to communities that are desperate for opportunity for their kids.
Governor DuPont.
Professor Edley, I'm going to leave aside that I don't believe there's been a teacher fired from a public school in America.
We ought to change that. We ought to change that.
In memory.
But we ought to change that, Governor.
I'd like to ask two of the questions that you posed to us to begin with about the model that we on this side of the table are talking about, which is the American university system. We have a choice system of universities in America. You can go to TCU, you can go to Connecticut, you can go to Delaware, you can go to Yale, you can go wherever you want. Looking at America's university system, I'd ask you the same two questions. Who will have choice and who will be left out? And who would you say is being left out of the American university system?
Well, I would like to focus on K-12 for the following reason. We have made a decision, we have made a judgment as a society that K-12 education must be universal, that it must provide a basic quality of education for the sake of citizenship and for the sake of opportunity. I want to address the fact that we are not living up to that ideal, and I'm in favor of it, but I'm not in favor of selling off the ideal. I'm not in favor of auctioning it off. I don't believe that giving people vouchers that are woefully inadequate to the task and saying that somehow it's going to transform education is going to work any more than I think that giving people food stamps has transformed supermarkets and grocery stores. It simply isn't going to work that way. There's the commitment to universality represented by public education. By public education is what distinguishes us from the situation in higher education.
Dr. Edney, I believe you're in the right church, but the wrong pew. You know that in the United States, there are more black males in prison than in college. And as your colleagues have stated so eloquently, if the majority of those people were being educated in public schools, then who is responsible for the lack of minorities in higher education?
Look, here's the problem. In my judgment, there is no single item on the opportunity agenda more important than improving K-12 education. No single item. The problem is that your remedy is like 18th century medicine. You're attaching a leech to bleed public education instead of healing the disease. You are going to siphon off You're siphoning off precious resources that are needed in order to work with the problems that the public education system faces. $2,000 or $3,000 in a voucher is not going to create opportunity for the millions of students that you and I care so much about. It simply isn't. Where are the slots? Which schools are going to take them? The question for your side to ask is to answer is, are you going to require that private schools take kids who come to school hungry?
That's a rhetorical question.
It is, yes, that's is. Right.
Thank
that's
you
right,
very much, Professor Edley.
It's a law professor, yeah, I'd like you to do it.
Brother Bob. Before you start, let me say applause is great. Booing and hissing really isn't, and I don't care what Ira Glasser says. I don't want to hear it in here. Go ahead.
Okay. Mr. Curry threw out a challenge, and you said that find me a group of parents who are on the lower socioeconomic strata, and I will show you people on their way to prison. I take offense at that, and the 50 graduates from my high school last Saturday take offense at that. Please. Of those 50 graduates, 95% are African American and Hispanic, 70% low income, 70% single parent family. They're not on their way to prison, they're on the way to 80 colleges around this country. In the dialogues of Plato, Socrates begins the apology by saying, "Gentlemen of Athens, as you listen to my accusers, I don't know how you felt. But I, in listening to them, almost forgot who I was. They were so persuasive. Yet they hardly uttered a word of truth." I'm not accusing the opposition of not uttering a word of truth, but I am accusing you of changing the parameters of this debate. See, this is not about giving more money to public schools. It's not about some conspiracy to close down the public school system. It's not about a separation of church and state. It is about giving parents and guardians the freedom to choose where they best feel their children can go to school.
Question. Question.
Brother Bob, I want to jump in here in somewhat agreement with Bill Curry's point for the following reason. I do not believe that we should make public policy by anecdote. There is no question but that there are countless families around the country, countless individuals who come out of poor circumstances and go on to do great things. No question about it. The question to you, however, is, are private schools required to take all poor children, or do they, as your school, enjoy the luxury of picking and choosing those students that they believe they can do a good job educating?
Dr. Edley, that is a fantastic question, and I am so glad that you asked it. 3 weeks ago, I was at the Mariana Islands in the South Pacific, and they asked that exact same question, and the Commissioner of Education told everyone gathered that we do not take all students in our public schools. And in fact, we have two students who are attending a private school here in Texas at the cost of $70,000 per student per year. In Milwaukee, Wisconsin, in the Student Selection Handbook, there are 25 elementary schools that say in bold writing, these are the requirements for admission. So the question of whether or not private or religious schools have to take everybody, the question is for everyone. Now, if you're asking me specifically at my school, we've got students that have been expelled from other schools. I've got a student right now with brain damage. I've got students that are ED, LD. We've got everybody, and I'm not sure who else we should be looking for.
Mr. Chase.
Yes, I have a question about the Milwaukee voucher program. Since you are from Milwaukee, you might be more familiar with it than others. It's my understanding that the voucher program has little or no state requirements as far as oversight and so on, which is what proponents of vouchers continue to praise as being one of the positive parts of it, deregulation and so on. I would just like to ask you what should be done to prevent the following situations from happening. In 1992, Virgil Academy closing during the first year. In 1997, another school indicted for criminal fraud, the voucher programs owing the state $111,000. In 1997, another one of these schools indicted for criminal fraud on voucher program funds, owing the state $88,000. In 1997, another school which closed in the middle of the year, several of these closed, by the way, in the middle of the year, and children then had to find other school, other settings in public schools. And right now, there are two additional academies that are in fiscal difficulties and may very well have to close, one owing the state $70,000 and another one a substantial amount of money.
Well, let's call that a question.
Mr. Chase, again, a very excellent question. In Milwaukee, the issue is not bad schools, it's bad management. And I think you know quite well that there are millions and millions of dollars that have been embezzled in public schools, but I'm not sure.
Mr. Chase, let me finish my answer, please.
I don't remember the last time I've seen a public school close because of that mismanagement.
I think Mr. Chase gets a few more seconds.
Let me first of all indicate what I was asking you was what kind of oversight should there be to prevent this, since schools are being created, voucher schools are being created with minimal or no oversight. That's the first point, and I don't think that that question was responded to, and that was the question that I asked.
Let me respond to it a different way. I'm a believer in the Paul Bear Bryant philosophy of business and of life, and I believe it not just for public schools, but for all schools, and it's very simple. Be good or be gone.
Still did not respond to the question I asked.
Mr. Curry.
Brother Bob, I certainly apologize if I said anything which offended you personally in my own remarks. I think we all posit that each of us is trying to speak the truth and nothing but the truth, but that none of us has the whole truth.
Actually, you can't speak the truth or falsehood at the moment. We're out of time.
Oh, no. What a great question.
Thank you, Brother Bob. No. Mr. Chase. This is Mr. Chase's opportunity to make an opening statement. Mr. Chase.
Thank you.
Mr. Buckley's champing at the bit over here. He'll get his chance.
I'll wait till you ask the questions, Mr. Buckley. I won't respond to an earlier.
Let me just indicate that I think there are probably six or seven very clear myths that surround the ideas embodied in vouchers. Myth number one is public support. It depends upon how the question is asked, and I can certainly point out to two different polling questions that were asked here in Texas during the last year as to whether or not the public supports vouchers, and certainly can point out to the fact that since 1990 there have been four states when it has been put on the ballots, and voters have had the opportunity to render a decision as to whether or not they want vouchers. And in each one of these four instances, the voters said no in at least a 2-to-1 vote. The second one is the myth of the voucher success in Milwaukee. The results have been shown and are clear, although there are conflicting studies. One study very clearly is flawed. The third one is a myth that private schools are always better. In 1994, Money Magazine, hardly a liberal magazine, and did a study that showed that the differences between public and private schools, when all things are taken into consideration, show that private schools are in fact not better, and recommended its readers not to make that investment. The fourth one is that public schools are a monopoly. Public schools are run by 15,000 different school boards across this country. 15,000 boards made up of people who are elected at the local level, and they determine how their schools are to be run. I find it very difficult to understand how 15,000 entities can be considered to be a monopoly. The fifth one, the idea that public schools are all failing. As has been said, there are public schools that are in trouble, and I certainly would not deny that. But scores and results that have been taken in tests and so on over the last few years have shown an increase in the progress made by public schools, and I think that given time, we're going to see that increase continue. The sixth one is that the myth that this is, in fact, religious persecution. There is a difference between religious freedom and subsidizing religions. And seventh, the myth that the opposition to vouchers comes only from special interest groups. In fact, we find opposition to vouchers from most parents, as polls show us, from most churches, and from most taxpayers.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Mansour.
Mr. Chase, the NEA has a publication. It's called The People's Cause, Mobilizing for Public Education. And it's a resource book that you give one of your 1,100 state and local associations about how to oppose vouchers. And in there it notes, when you call the League of Women Voters, you'll want to focus on the public good issues. Resegregation alerts minority groups. It then adds, ask the PTA and the League of Women Voters to assume leadership of the coalition. The polls show they have more credibility on the issue. Mr. Chase, hasn't the defeat of scholarship proposals up to now been more due to your large political effectiveness and the expenditure of millions of dollars, much of which came from teachers who are not in favor of your opposition, than a true discussion on the issues?
I don't think that's the case at all. As a matter of fact, if that were the case, I would have to say, what about the $2 million that was expended by the organization that you're involved in attempting to get vouchers through the Texas State Legislature this year? Was that something that was wrong by you doing that? You tried to educate the public through ads and so on from your perspective in what you believe is right. I think that that's the American way. And if you have the right to do that here in Texas, then certainly we have the right and responsibility as educators to do that around the country.
Mr. Buckley.
Mr. Chase, you shrink from the use of the word monopoly to describe the existing situation. Now, the average European country has 4 to 5 public unions to which teachers belong. We have 2, yours and the AFT. Is there not an inbuilt monopoly situation when a teacher has only those 2 choices?
I think your information is wrong, Mr. Buckley. As a matter of fact, here in the state of Texas, there are 5. There are 5 unions, associations that teachers can belong to. There are also several. No, there are several in other states too. If you're talking
about
are there 2 major unions? The answer is correct. Are you talking about in France? Are there 2 or 3 out of 5? The answer is correct.
I'm talking about national unions, obviously, not about...
And I'm talking about national unions as well.
Not about PTAs.
No, I'm not talking about PTAs at all.
All right, children, Governor.
Mr. Chase, Cardinal O'Connor in New York City offered to take at no cost the least 5% achieving students in the New York City public school system and educate them in the Catholic schools for nothing. Mm-hmm. Would you advise the School Board of New York City to accept that offer?
I think there might be some willingness to advise them if, in fact, all the way through that program, there was totally devoid of any questions as it relates to religion. Because schools are not religious institutions. Schools are places where education is to take place. Now, if people choose to send their child to a religious school, that's certainly well within their right, and I respect that right to do so. But not at government expense, not at my expense if it's another religion, or would, in fact, someone who is a Catholic appreciate the fact that somebody who is a Muslim or a Jew or whatever other religion was going to go to a school that was in fact, run by people of that faith, and would, in fact, have as one of their main missions, as many schools do, as was referenced earlier, education in that particular faith. The separation of church and state is a very, very strong, important part of our Constitution. In every instance that it has been brought to the courts have clearly said that the separation of church and state must be adhered to, and that includes the voucher programs in both Milwaukee and in Cleveland.
Why did it take so long to discover that?
I beg your pardon, sir?
The McCollum decision was 1948. Are you suggesting that between 1791 and 1948, we were just in a complete fog.
No, I'm not saying that at all.
Indispensable.
But are you suggesting to me, sir, that in colonial Virginia, when Thomas Jefferson decided that they had to build the University of Virginia because William and Mary was becoming too entwined with the religious institutions at that time, that he was in a fog?
You won't answer my question then as to why we had to wait that long.
Mr. Buckley can answer your question if he wishes during his time, which comes up now. Thank you, Mr. Who on the opposition team wants to start the questioning of the captain?
Mr. Buckley, following up in part on one of Brother Smith's points, and that is whether or not issues, social problems, including poverty and race, lie at bottom of many of the concerns that we have. Do you feel that the primary problem in the productivity and skill levels of children in our cities is bad teachers and educational bureaucracy?
No.
Or do you feel that those issues of poverty, race, drugs, and culture?
Sin. And I know at least the Christian-oriented colleges are trying very hard to do something about that. The primary problem in the urban is, as you say, complicated. And we're not saying that there's going to be a magical transformation in anybody who crosses the street from this public school on over to this parochial school. We're simply saying that parents who think that might be a good idea oughtn't to be thought of as conspirators against your freedom to guard your children against being inculcated by Christianity. So that's my answer to your question.
I'm only worried about them being inculcated by whatever your particular brand of religion might be. I want them inculcated by the brand that I choose for them. But let me ask you this.
Well, you must tell me what now, wait a minute. You can't hit and run that way.
Oh.
But what is it about my position that you find so dogmatically offensive? You ought to tell me. In other words, what do I believe in that offends you so much?
Well, I think Ira Glasser read charters, suggestions of charters that are in some of these schools, don't you believe that that a school that says bring your child here because we are going to teach them to believe what we believe?
Practically every school in America said that at some point. Yale and Harvard and Princeton, all, for instance, said that in the 18th century, 17th century in one case.
They don't
get up now and say, we renounce.
Bill,
what
I know
it was
you like to live in the 18th century, but they saying it now.
Captain Curry, keep your
tongue. Try to calm these guys down.
So they are saying it now because there's a certain constancy there. But you really make it sound as though these were drill masters in the Ten Commandments who pay no attention to the mathematics. Why is it that they exceed the public school students in math,
But Mr. Buckley, let's say this isn't all a matter of conspirators, and let's say that everyone isn't some kind of sectarian zealot. Let me just make sure I understand how far you do go. Louis Farrakhan, the Reverend Moon, all the private academies in the South that sprang up in response to desegregation in order to perpetuate segregation, are they all entitled to subsidy through tax dollars, or aren't they?
We're talking about you're talking about a quarrel that took place in this country between Brown v. Boards of Education and the abandonment of Jim Crow in education. That was an evolutionary quarrel, which fortunately didn't take a... Wait a minute, am I answering this? It didn't take a civil war to solve that problem. Yeah. It took an adjudication and a gradual acceptance by schools everywhere that they could not engage in Jim Crow practices within the school. This was entirely consistent, by the way, with the Christian message that one should teach, one should regard one's brother as a brother. And I think that the leading role taken by such as Adam Clayton, Martin Luther King, and other important Christian dignitaries showed the strength of that particular commandment in guiding the teaching of the people you're talking about.
And so when you take someone, let me just go to the whole question. You take Reverend Moon, for instance, who buys up newspapers and universities without disclosing his identity to the public to whom he's peddling his wares,
or
Louis Farrakhan. Are
can
those people eligible?
Wait a minute. Here's a hit and run business again. Without disclosing his identity, would suggest that what then happens after he buys them is not traceable to this radically different posture. The Washington Times is, what, 15 years old? I defy anybody to read it and say this is moon-ish.
So he does get the subsidy.
I occasionally have that. But Moon, Farrakhan, and the segregated academies all get the money under your proposal. Is that the bottom line?
No. The bottom line is that the parent can pick the school.
So yes,
now, a lot of people who had the GI Bill went, in my judgment, to crazy places. But it never occurred to me to say that you shouldn't be free to go to crazy places.
The essence of your...
And at 18 years old, you're likely to go to a crazy place. It reflects a greater blame on your judgment, since we've all been instructed that you're a mature and impressionable, or mature, which was it?
Let me ask.
In the 18th century.
Why was it they were free under the GI Bill to go to wherever they wanted to? Because they were no longer impressionable.
That's this size rhetorical question. Thank you very much, Mr. Buckley. Well, Mr. Curry. Mr. Buckley, you can start with that question if you wish to Mr. Curry.
Sorry?
If you wish to ask that question again to Mr. Curry.
May I? My question is, at what age do you people decide that it's okay for somebody to pick his own schools? Is it 18 at which you can pick your own school, but not if 16?
Yeah, it's 18.
And what is it? What is the magical?
18.
Tell me a little bit about the sociology or the pedagogy that goes into the devising of that age. Is it
sure,
like driver's license
sure.
and voting?
Sure. There's a certain arbitrariness to it. Mm-hmm. 18, you go to war. 18, you vote. We now have drinking at 21. There's a whole that society wrestles with these. And when you get to the final calibration, you can always make it look silly. But whether, as Governor DuPont raised earlier, this carries to some constitutional significance, there's a question here of basic common sense. These are children. I don't know what 18, 19, and 20, at what levels of maturity. I didn't read up on Piaget before I came over. But the fact of the matter is that at 5 and 6 and 7 and 8, a child in the hands of an irresponsible, not in the hands of Brother Bob Smith, I'd have my child there any day. But the notion
permitting a parent to make those decisions, Mr. Curry?
You know, I don't always. One of our problems.
What you and your colleagues are saying
my life was entrusted to two wonderfully responsible parents, and I wouldn't be here talking to you now if that hadn't happened. I have a third of the children who are eligible for Medicaid not getting any coverage because their parents aren't responsible enough to bring them to a doctor. I have physical, emotional, and sexual abuse of children, which I believe going on in this country is the root cause of much of the malfunction.
Well, maybe parents shouldn't be allowed to have children.
No. But the simple question is that not every parent is paying attention. And it is true, intending to offend no one, Brother Bob, but it is true that the poorer you get, the more likely these children are to be left to their own devices. One of the biggest problems we have in this country is that between the hours of 3 and 7 every day, when 70% of all the juvenile crime in the United States is committed, when 100% of the homework is supposed to be being done, we have functionally abandoned our children.
If parents request that their child go to another school, it seems to me you have manifest evidence that the parent is concerning himself with that child.
One of the things that we were at the beginning of this, sure, I think that's a good point. One of the points, though, that we were at the beginning was that there are choices involved. And I know there are parents who would like to use tax dollars to send their children to racially segregated academies. I know what's happened. That's the first kind of voucher privatization experiment in this country, and it's still going on today. Doesn't you have to go back to Brown versus the Board of Education? And I know what's happened to the children who were left behind. I don't want to make the many the casualties of the choices made on behalf of the few. There are choices here about money, about resources, about the kinds of schools we have. The debate has to begin in a recognition that taking from one to give to another at least has to be accounted for.
I think we might agree on that, Mr. Curry, but let me ask you a question that a mother from here in Fort Worth asked me on the phone last Friday. She had heard about the debate and was happy that we were coming down here to fight for the rights of parents. And she said, would you ask the opposing side to explain to me
why I have to pay money in taxes to support a public school system that doesn't work, and then when I choose to send my kids to a private school, I have to pay again. Why can't I use that first batch of tax money to send my child where I want them to go?
And first of all, the question is, and the answer, rather, first of all, is that all of our actions have consequences. When this very question was framed, that somehow that the federal government or the government not discriminate against private institutions, as if our unwillingness to subsidize those institutions were some form of discrimination unto itself, that every unsubsidized activity is somehow a victim of discrimination. I don't know. As a person of some faith, I feel that my own doesn't require a federal subsidy.
Why can't you?
I feel that in all the aspects and dimensions of my life in which I pursue that, in the end, I'm safer and better off in making those choices in the private sphere. I think that when that mother makes that choice and other responsible mothers make that choice, that some very large number that I don't think you've taken into account, 50, 60, 70, maybe 80%, are left behind in a system which increasingly merely warehouses them,
Curry,
in a society which increasingly forgets them.
Mr. Curry, let me make sure
I think
that
we have to at least understand
time,
whether those
this
are
the questioner's time.
Well, that's a pretty good point.
Ask a
go
five
ahead.
Second
my question. I'm sorry.
I mean, in your few seconds, you only got 7 seconds left here. As
like
I understand your point, when you're 18, you can make your own choice where to go to school, but you can't choose. You can't choose for your
no,
child.
My point is that adults and children are different, and we have responsibilities
the mothers are
to
chewing,
children.
Right?
We have responsibilities
choosing, right?
to children that we don't have to adults, and all of us have obligations of stewardship and parenting to the children in this country, whether they are our own or not.
Thank you very much, Mr. Curry. Mm-hmm. Mr. Mansour and Professor Edley. And Mr. Mansour, you begin by questioning Professor Edley.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Professor Edley, you said something in your opening statement I found somewhat interesting. You said that giving a voucher to a parent won't really transform the public system in any way. Where did you get your data, and what are you basing that on?
Why do you think it would? I don't see any evidence that it would. I see nothing to suggest that it would. You're talking about again. The difficulty is it is twofold. First of all, schools are not like soap powder. Secondly, the efforts of schools in your privatized system to attract students, to market themselves to parents, et cetera. I mean, I'm all in favor of the free enterprise system, but attracting students is not the same as educating students. Attracting students is not the same as educating students. You can look at the scandals with respect to the post-secondary voc ed system, where we have a GI Bill type system. And the fact of the matter is, a lot of people put down a lot of good money to go to vocational education schools and get virtually nothing out of it. We talk about the wonderful successes of the higher education system, and it's true that we have some of the best in the world, but it's also the case that 15 to 20% of graduates of four-year institutions in this country, this according to the U.S. Department of Education, 15 to 20% fail at basic literacy tests like interpreting an appliance warranty, applying for a Social Security card. Mm-hmm. So attracting students, marketing yourself to students, is not the same thing as educating them.
Well, let me ask you this, Professor, and you say there's no evidence to the contrary, I believe, is what you're basing your premise on, that vouchers won't work. If I could show you 10, 15,000 kids who have exercised and used vouchers, who are low income, who are coming from failing schools, who are typically 1 to 2 grade points, grade levels behind their private school counterparts. And when they went out to make their decisions, there was 20 or 30 schools waiting on their possible enrollment. And today, after 2-3 years in their new institution, they are performing remarkably well. Would that change your mind?
If you could show me decent social science that suggested that the kind of thing that you're suggesting could work on a broad scale, then I might change my view. The fact of the matter is that all of the research that's been done, with the exception of one extraordinarily shoddy study co-authored by someone who teaches at Harvard,
yeah.
is suggests that the differences evaporate when you control for how much education does the mother have, what's the income of the students, et cetera. The problem with the experiments that you would identify in Milwaukee or elsewhere, the problem with them is the selectivity of the schools in which students they accept and which students they keep over a period of time. When, for most of these schools, perhaps not Brother Bob's, but for most of them, when the schools start to have trouble with a kid, they kiss the kid goodbye. Public schools do not have that luxury.
Well, let me ask you this. Professor, it's becoming pretty clear to me that a lot of your information and what you base your decisions on have to do with academic studies and research. And by the way, the Peterson study, co-authored, as you say, by someone from Harvard, has been now endorsed by a second study from a professor at Princeton. The academic research is now weighing in favor of academic performance, in favor of the Milwaukee Voucher Plan. But let me offer this to you. Maybe we need to get you out of the hallways of Harvard and come down to the real world, and let me show you students who have used vouchers, who are now excelling with those vouchers on a broad scale, any one of 30 cities where we have programs.
Look, there's absolutely no doubt in my mind that vouchers can work in some places for some kids. But by the same token, you have to recognize that public schools work in many places for many kids, including kids who are as poor as they come, in as difficult circumstances as they come. The fact that I can identify particular schools, particular teachers that have had enormous success in public school, it seems to me, does not make the case that public education is perfect. And similarly, the fact that you can suggest that there are some voucher programs that show some promise does not mean it is a prescription for all the children of America.
It's your turn now, Professor Edley, to ask questions of Mr. Mansour.
80% of the private schools in this country, 80% have no Hispanic students enrolled in them. 63% have no African American students enrolled in them. My question is, what will prevent, in a privatized education system, a system of racial and economic segregation?
Do you have any ideas to why, if your numbers are correct, why possibly Hispanics and African Americans might not be in private schools?
The numbers are a 1994 report of the U.S. Department of Education.
Do you have any ideas to why they may not be?
I think there are a lot of reasons, including the fact that the people who run those private schools exercise choice in who they decide to admit, including the fact that the price of those schools puts it out of reach of the vast majority.
Now you're talking.
Vouchers at the level that you're suggesting, $2,000 or $3,000 per person, will not even come remotely close to closing that gap.
That's your question.
Professor, once again, I really do, this is sincere, I encourage you to spend a day with me. I have seen these children, I have been in these cities, and I know what choice can do.
Public policy by anecdote.
Let me offer why there might not be as many, and it's financial. When a child gets one of our vouchers, in Austin, they have 55 schools who are ready and willing and able to accept them. You need more choices? If we encourage them and empower them to make decisions by providing them the financial resources they need to make those decisions, there'll be plenty of schools who can take them, and we can change
the numbers. How many students are you talking about?
We're talking about 14,000 right now.
How many students are in the system?
What system?
You're talking about Austin? How many students are in the Austin system?
In Austin system, the numbers are somewhere around 40,000.
Well, so I don't understand where the spaces are going to come from if a substantial number of these students opt for the space. Where is your $3,000 figure coming from as the cost of educating students in private school?
Actually, it's less than that. The national average is $3,000. Here in Texas, we're experiencing southward of $2,700.
Well, I'm sorry,
for
but the
private
the,
school education.
According to the Department of Education, the median nationally is $10,700. The median parochial is about $3,000.
That's absolutely incorrect. Once again, we have over 14,000 students in 30 different cities, and our average is less than $3,000. The average is
I understand that.
Yeah.
But that's the schools to which you are sending your kids. I'm talking about the universe of schools. If you're talking about just that pool that's willing to accept your students, that they very well, they may be very low, they may have lower tuitions. But here's the question: does the $3,000 or so, which is a typical for tuition at a parochial school, that includes contributions made by the church, contributions made by parishioners, contributions made by alumni, all of those resources that go to reduce the per student cost of educating in parochial schools? You know, until recently, the majority of teachers in those schools were nuns,
Yes.
Right? So the question is, how are the costs of opening this kind of privatization broadly going to be born if you're only talking about $2,000 or $3,000 per voucher?
Because it'll give them a seat at most private schools in the country, which is what we want to do. Unfortunately, Mr. Glasser and others have sort of prostitutionalized that number, because there are certain elite academies that are $10,000, such as the one that the president sends his school and the child to.
Will these private schools that you're interested in accept students who speak Cambodian?
That is another rhetorical question. Thank you very much, Mr. Edley. Thank you very much, Mr. Mansour. Mr. Buckley, Mr. Curry. Mr. Curry. Mr. Buckley, you question Mr. Curry.
Oh, okay. Mr. Curry, let's get factual, since we were invited to do so by your team. So let me ask a hypothetical question. You got a school with a public school with 1,000 students. 200 of them pull out and go to wherever. Now, what kind of diminution would you expect in the expenses of running that public school? Now, don't tell me they're going to shorten the tennis court by 20%. But
these are all hypothetical facts we're doing now. Okay. But first of all, I don't have a factual answer, because it is a hypothesis. My guess would be that for some of the very reasons your team has cited, that the administrative costs are so high in the public school system, they need to be lowered, because work rules can be rigid. They need to be made more flexible. Teachers and administrators working together need to do that. That in fact you wouldn't get the kind of reduction in cost that you might
wouldn't get the potato 20%. Okay. But now, there would be a reduction, and we began by acknowledging, or do you dispute it, that the administrative costs, for instance, in New York, to deal with a non-hypothetical situation, are enormous by consequence. I remember an exchange between, it was a Monsignor, if you can permit the expression, and he represented the administration of the parochial schools, which they do about 20%, 18% of the schooling in New York City, and the lady who was in charge of the administration or representing of the other schools. And she was asked, how many people administer the New York public schools? She said, well, we have 9,200. So then they turned to the mother, well, how many do you have? Well, he said, then see, there's Lucinda, there's Eric, there's, it turned out to be like 20.
Is there
now,
a question?
Would we not expect that there might be a corresponding tightening up of those schools, as was suggested by Mr. Mansour in Milwaukee?
I think, first of all, that the answer is that you could expect that over time, and that it ought to happen more quickly than it's likely to happen, and that the government in its entirety and school systems in particular need to do what the need to undergo the experience the private sector just had to put itself through of flattening out its hierarchies, of decentralizing, more site-based management, more people in direct service.
So there would
delivery.
Be a diminution, therefore,
all
in
of those
the expenses.
Things need to happen, and we won't be able to, if we don't do some of those things, your team will win in the ultimate debate.
Therefore, we'll say that it's unresolved where that money that you're talking about would materialize, if indeed there were corresponding reductions in the cost of public running public schools.
Was it 200 and 800, the hypothetical, 200 out of 800?
Well, I said, yeah, I said if there were 20% reduction in a particular school, what would be the reduction in operating costs?
Let me just say this. The first part of the hypothetical that's defective is the idea that somehow we're going to wake up tomorrow and double the number of private school students in this country. If you want every last shred of the argument that we could wake up this year or next year or the year after and find some place decent and habitable to place all these children, that there would be some seamless movement, that we wouldn't be sacrificing in some ways or risk sacrificing. Well, therefore, number one, the math doesn't work because there aren't enough places. In Milwaukee, lots of students who were approved were turned down and went back to the system. They're not ready. They're not even close to ready. For all of you who so criticized
You forgot my hypothesis, which if it happened, how much money would materialize? Let me ask you a second question. You seem to emphasize hugely this 18-year-old business. Does the ACLU take the position that it's okay to give public money to a Texas Christian university because students there are 18 years old?
First of all, I won't be speaking for Ira over the course of this. He'll have to handle that himself. But let me just say this. I understand the seeming foolishness of saying that 18 as opposed to 18 and a quarter or 18 and a half or 19 makes all the difference in assembling people's rights. But to say that we don't distinguish different sets of rights and obligations from and to the parties for children, adolescents, adults, it seems to me, as I said earlier, to lack common sense. There is a difference. There's a vast difference between what I'm willing to support an adult doing, whether at Texas Christian or at Harvard. Whatever particular faith people might acquire in either place is really their business and not mine.
You know, I don't, out of this world, because there are about 95% of what you Democrats want that I don't support. I mean, I wouldn't voluntarily give my money to the most of your ventures, but I simply have to because you won the election. But I'm saying if we win the election and establish that parents have a restoration of rights, shouldn't you acknowledge your corollary burden?
Answer that and then turn it around.
No. I'd like to ask Mr. Buckley, first of all, as he looks back upon the other examples in public policy of opening up the purse strings of taxpayers in order to give people amounts of money to spend securing necessities of life, which of these precedents he would cite as being most useful in predicting the effectiveness of this mass revolution that that you espouse here today? Would it be Section 8?
You got a problem here, and that is that you can confuse supply with demand. If there is a supply side factor involved, i.e. the government is going to start backing engineering students, it won't be long before they start saying what the schools that treat those engineers may or may not do. If, however, it's a situation where the engineering student decides where he wants to go, then it's like food stamps. You get food stamps from the government, but there's no pressure on you to patronize this store rather than another store. So that's the basic distinction.
Sure, but let's in fact take a look at things that are as essential to one's well-being as a quality education. In fact, let's look at education itself. One of the things that the economists who support this position often say is that democratic economists tend to see a static world and not understand growth. One of the areas in which growth comes is in price. Yes, we've done many honorable things to support people seeking training and education in college and beyond. And we've opened up billions of dollars in federal and state subsidies for student loans, Pell Grants, and so forth. At the same time, because there was no regulation whatsoever of the institutions receiving the money, we had a rate of inflation in college education, which has placed college education outside the reach, increasingly, of middle-class Americans.
Well,
opening
the,
up one more pocket.
In the last 20 years, college education has risen 300% faster than inflation. So now, remind me what your question was.
My question is that as we open up each of these subsidies, don't we, in fact, whether it's opening up massive health care subsidies and watching the cost of health care. The two greatest subsidies of government were health care and education. Those were the two greatest rates of inflation. As we open up these billions upon billions of dollars, won't the costs that you're dealing with increase dramatically? Haven't you spent your life fighting the kinds of effects that those programs have had?
No, the answer is no, because if it's a demand-side situation, then you have a consumer. The consumer has, as things now stand, zero choice in most situations. He can send his children to public schools or go to jail. That's the choice he has. In a situation that we are attracted to, that parent has more choices. It might be a parochial school, it might be a charter school, whatever it is, there is an incentive for that parent to look for the best deal, the highest quality education at the least cost, which is deflationary.
You can seek health care or die or get a college education or be poor. I think most of us face more Hobson's choices than you recognize. Let me just switch topics and ask that we return to an earlier discussion. That question as to whether or not poverty, race, child abuse, exposure to violence and drugs within the community in which you live, in the role in which those and other cultural forces have played.
You haven't come agreeing, to the verb in your sentence yet.
Agreeing.
It's all subject, let alone the predicate.
I'll never live down the fact that you made that point to me. But looking at that, I wanted to ask whether in your analysis of this problem, you've asked yourself what the effect will be on all the children who don't participate in choice, whether you've stopped and asked what
the
impact of your proposal would be.
When they grow up, they'll wish that their parents had better judgment or better resources or whatever. I can't imagine, there are a lot of situations in which people, when they're 21 years old, are glad that their parents handled them exactly as they did, and there's some in which they said, no, they might say no, they wish they'd gone somewhere else or whatever. But it seems to me, on the grounds that you can't improve 100% of the situation, you just disdain to improve 50% of the situation.
Thank you both of you. Thank you, Mr. Curry. Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Governor DuPont.
Gentlemen.
I just have one question, Mr. DuPont. Actually,
it's providing you with an opportunity to correct a statement that you made before. You made a statement before that you know of no public school teachers who have been fired. Is that accurate?
I know of none. That's
okay,
accurate.
Then I would like to provide you with an opportunity to spend some time with me at another time, and I can go over your data, statistics, introduce you to people, and also, by the way, to share with you the number of people that we as an organization have counseled out of the profession for the very reasons that you said they should not be there.
Well, I'm delighted if that, in fact, has happened.
Governor, I'd like to go back to this question of who's going to have the choice, and I'm concerned about the possibility that many of these schools who will now be subsidized under your scheme will choose to have as few minorities as possible, as few students with disabilities as possible, as few students who don't speak English as possible, as few people who don't belong to the country club as possible. What in your system will prevent that a kind of exclusionary practice, or do you find it perfectly acceptable?
First, I think that your use of the word subsidy is wrong to the school. The scholarship goes to the parents. I don't think any of the people in the audience here who have a scholarship to Texas Christian would argue that the government is subsidizing the school. They're giving a scholarship to the kids. Maybe a minor point, but worth making. But in regard to your question, my first answer would be that the pattern you'll see in elementary and secondary education will be very much the same as you see in university and colleges and non-public vocational education. Are there colleges that don't have any Hispanics in them? I don't know. Perhaps there are.
Yes.
Do you think that is destroying the fabric of America? I haven't noticed that.
It's it ain't helping.
Secondly, there are some 3,000 schools in America that are educating more than 100,000 disabled kids, private schools, because mostly the public schools, when the disability gets to be too much, can't handle it. And so those kids are moved at public expense to a private school. And the question that frustrates parents is that they look and they see that their children are in the Newark, New Jersey school system, which is educationally bankrupt and taken over by the state, and say, why does my kid have to stay there? Why can't they leave? What would you say to that?
The problem is that the only circumstances in which generally public schools send a disabled child to a private placement is when the costs of doing so and the technology and the resources needed to do so are simply unavailable in the public system. But when public schools can do it, they do it.
Yes.
Will private schools do the same? I think...
They are doing the same. There's thousands of them making a living doing it.
When they're hugely subsidized.
Mr. Glasser.
Mr. DuPont, when we were both up at the podium at the beginning, I asked you to confront the fact that if you really want a choice, you had to deal with the fact that 75, maybe 90% of the private schools in this country charge tuitions which are significantly larger than any voucher ever proposed. Now, Mr. Mansour responded to that $10,300 median figure by saying it wasn't true, which is a convenient form of denial. But it was published by the National Association of Independent Schools in a story in the Times. And I want to ask you to come to grips. Let's assume, for the sake of argument, that choice is a good idea, both inside the public system and in the private system, both. And it is our job to encourage choice, both publicly and privately. And we can both come up with great examples of public choice.
All right. We got
how are you going to deal with the cost when it's not enough?
There are millions. That's an exaggeration.
Yes, it is.
There are hundreds of thousands of places available today in public schools, in private schools across this country, where for a $3,000 voucher, you could go there, or the parents could make up perhaps another $1,000 or so of difference.
Good. Thank you, Governor. Mr. Glasser. Questions for Mr. Glasser?
May I? Ms. Glasser.
Only if it's about baseball.
This business about 18 years old, I asked Mr. Chase, and he... Mr. Curran, he very adroitly said that he wasn't here to give your views. Are you here to give your views?
I'm certainly not here to give yours.
Well, I know. But we make way for late vocations. You can desert tomorrow if you like.
Well, I want to ask a question.
The ACLU does not recognize this distinction you've been promoting here between people who are 18 who are not. You are opposed to any federal money being used by
Let's get real about what we're talking about. If I have a son who reaches the age of 18 and he wants to convert to another religion or even, God help us, subscribe to the National Review, that is his business. It may be an indication of my failure as a parent, but that is his business. But when he is 5 years old and it is my and my wife's decision to send him to kindergarten,
Do you have any objection to your 18-year-old student using federal money to attend Texas Christian University?
What I am telling you is what people do as adults is different than what parents choose for children.
I know that.
I didn't ask you that.
Are you in favor of the GI Bill?
Look, the fact is,
you refuse
the fact
to answer.
Is that you, on that side of the room, are making an argument that parents ought to be able to say, I don't want to go to the school anymore, I want to go to the school I want my kid to go to. I said at the beginning, I love that idea. And I also said that your proposal will not come close to accomplishing it and will make everything worse.
So you're against the GI Bill. You're against the GI Bill.
You are not willing to come up with enough money, and you are not willing to increase taxes.
What you want to do is
give people $3,000, which will go to the people who already can afford private schools.
Brother Bob.
Let me ask you.
Brother Bob.
Mr. Glasser, I believe you or someone on your panel mentioned earlier that The polls in this country show that people were not in favor of vouchers. I'd like you to respond to how many of those polls asked people who were low income.
Well, it's very interesting. The one of the polls that I saw that made that distinction had 57% of people who were low income and minority students. 50% of those parents said that they favored vouchers. Then they were asked whether or not they favored vouchers if private schools retained the discretion not to admit their kids. And then they were asked if private schools ought to be required to take everybody and to create special services for kids with special needs and would not be allowed to expel them. And when they were told that that is not the situation, their support went down way below 50%.
Mr. Mansour.
Let me ask you this question. I'm going to I think the poll numbers that you're using, you need to look at some of the ones that have been taken, of course, in this state, where 62% of the population favors this type of voucher plan. But let me ask you this about the ALU's stance on other issues. It appears to me that y'all have promoted individual rights when it comes to pornography, abortions, and beggars' access to donors. But when it comes to a parent's right to choose access to a number of schools for their child, you have fallen on the side of government. Does this seem to be a...
Like with a lot else that you said, it's not true. You're not any more familiar with the statistics about what private school tuition are than you are with ACLU positions. I support choice.
Let me read you. I support the choice.
You asked me a question, yeah. I'm giving you the answer.
You got 10
Your proposal does not provide it. Your proposal provides money to people who can already afford to send their kids to private schools. It's a windfall for the rich. It ain't choice for the poor.
Thank you, Dr. Mr. Barrasso. Brother Smith and Mr. Chase. And Brother Smith, you can start by questioning Mr. Chase.
Thank you. Mr. Chase, someone on your panel mentioned a couple times that public schools don't have the luxury of kissing goodbye to certain students. That's not totally accurate. In most urban school districts around the country, you have what are called alternative schools. And everybody in those cities knows that those are schools for kids who have been habitually tardy to school or absent, kids who have committed offenses that folks don't like. And you have the ability to expel students from public schools. You just have to pay for their education to whoever accepts them, but that—that's
not expelling.
Being given,
that's not
that's
expelling all, that, kids from public school. What that
question.
Is saying, we as a public school system, we have the responsibility to ensure that we educate all children. If these children are having difficulty in school X, then it's our responsibility to create school Y, to help that child be educated, to help that child meet his or her needs, so that that child will become a public citizen who is productive. The public school system is a system that created that alternative school, is a system that pays for that alternative school. What it is creating choice within the public school system, which we are supportive of.
Are you saying that the students who are assigned to alternative schools in the inner city are choosing those schools?
In some... In some instances, the answer is absolutely yes, and I can bring you to several of those schools, including one in the school district in which I taught, that those children chose to be there and continue to choose to be there and are being particularly well educated.
Let me ask you this question. The issue of choice has been talked about in terms of how the president and the vice president and Jesse Jackson all send their children to private schools in Washington, D.C. Please tell me why that same opportunity should not be given to poor parents.
Tell me how the voucher program that has been proposed is going to get a poor child into Sidwell Friends. Tell me how, if that family has two or three...
Is that a rhetorical question?
No, not at all. It's not a rhetorical question at all. Voucher programs that are for $2,500 or $3,000 and going to Sidwell Friends, which is $12,000, $13,000, or $14,000. We're not talking about getting poor children into those elite schools. You know that, and I know that. Mm-hmm. We're talking about getting poor children into other schools, most of which are religiously affiliated, and there are constitutional questions there that are very important and need to be addressed.
What's wrong if the parent wants to do that? What's wrong with the parent saying, I want my child to go to a Baptist school?
There is nothing wrong with the parent saying that, but if a parent says that, then it's the parent's responsibility to pay for it, or use the program that Mr. Mansour has been talking about, which is a privately funded voucher program. It's not publicly funded, and that's been confused all throughout this program. And we talk about the 14,000 scholarships that are being provided by your organization. That is private money that is donated privately, that is not public funds that's being used, and there is a very big difference.
Mr. Chase, the difference is in terminology. You keep saying, and everyone here keeps saying, publicly funded. Well, aren't the poor and middle class the public? Isn't it their money?
Answer that question and then go on to the answer that question and then start asking questions.
Let me indicate to you, when you're talking about public dollars being used for things that are questionable constitutionally, that we cannot put the Constitution aside for the convenience of argument and say that it should be the Constitution or sections of the Constitution should be abrogated in order to make this the case. That is incorrect. That cannot be done. It is illegal, and the courts have found it to be in case after case after case.
Now, Mr. you can ask Brother Bob.
Let me ask you a couple of questions. It has been claimed that vouchers will help children achieve more academically. I would like to have evidence presented to me that shows that to be the case.
It's a good question, Mr. Chase. I think both the Harvard and Princeton studies have shown marketable increase in terms of math and reading scores, quite different from what the Witte study from the University of Wisconsin showed. And the fact of the matter is the Wisconsin Accounting Bureau or the Audit Bureau could not substantiate Witte's findings that there was no difference between choice and non-choice students.
Would you agree with me that most researchers have looked at the Peterson study, Green-Peterson study, and have said the following is the case, that there have been inappropriate sampling methods that have been used that cannot, let me finish please, that cannot be documented as correct, that appropriate statistical methods were not used, and also that reasonable interpretation of statistical results are not there. As a matter of fact, you can look at the statistics at the back of this study and then go to the front of the study and look at the interpretation of these statistics, and in many instances, they just do not equate.
Now, Mr. Chase, I have not heard that. What I have heard is that Dr. Witte's study from the University of Wisconsin was not offered out for peer review. Dr. Peterson's study was.
Let me say that's not true, first of all. It's just the opposite. Just the opposite. Dr. Witte's study was. But let me also indicate to you then, if this is the case, then we're talking about dueling studies.
We could be.
Okay, and there are legitimate points of view from the Witte study, perhaps, and legitimate points of view from the Peterson study. So there is no one who can currently say all studies that have been done and the research that have been done unequivocally say that vouchers are, in fact, enhancing educational opportunity for children there.
I think the answer to that question is that parents are happy having their children in the schools that they choose.
So the question is then, do voucher schools, or are voucher schools created in order to make parents happy, or are voucher schools created in order to enhance the educational opportunity of youngsters?
Voucher schools don't need to be created. Private schools already exist. Now, are you asking
about your situations then?
Are you asking, will there be new schools cropping up? Absolutely, and there should be. But we are not creating schools.
Like the ones I referenced earlier.
We are not creating schools because of the voucher program.
Then there won't be enough schools in order to serve all of the students who might want to take advantage of vouchers, as was explained previously.
You know, I listened to that dialogue going back and forth about who's going to serve all of the students. And let me just say again, as I said in the beginning, I believe with all of my mettle
that we need high-quality public schools.
And
that's
sure
who I expect to also improve. But I also know that most institutions, schools included, do not improve unless there is pressure from outside.
Thank you both. Thank you for all the time. Thank you very much. It's the moment for closing arguments, and I call upon Mr. Curry for the opposition to close.
We've heard impassioned arguments on both sides. I would suggest that there are still questions that must be in the minds of the handful of the truly undecided who joined us today. I think that there's still a question as to whether or not we've learned the real economics of the plans that are put forward here. I don't think much in this life comes for free. There's a pretty obvious price tag on all of this. We have to make some decision as to what it is that we will diminish funding for in order to move it here. There seems almost no recognition of that in the arguments of the other side. I think that there are basic questions about the schools. Let me be so brave as to suggest that public schools are a little better than this entire national debate has led on, and that the problems of our children that have increased so dramatically in the last few years are not simply because of the callousness or indifference or ineptitude of teachers, that there are other forces that are staring us in the face that this debate ought to be focused on. The great achievement of the last generation in this country was to lift the elderly out of poverty, to ensure that old age would no longer be simply a gradual slippage into poverty and indignity. The great shame of my own generation is that this generation is allowing our children to slide in ever greater numbers into poverty. And a real discussion of the problems of academic achievement and social adjustment of the children in this country will eventually, I believe, when we're thinking more clearly, lead us down the path to those kinds of discussions and those kinds of changes. Let me lastly just say that there is much that is broken in public education that needs to be fixed. I truly believe that we need to extend school hours so that children who've been functionally abandoned in the late afternoons and early evenings and on weekends by this entire society get the care and attention they need. When I was a young child, there was always an adult around who knew what I was supposed to be doing and what I was likely to do if I was doing something other than what I was supposed to be doing. These kids are without that attention. This isn't about liberals and conservatives or Democrats and Republicans. It's about the basic character of a nation that we stand behind our children
thank
in that
you
way.
Very much, Mr. Curry. Mr.
Thank
Buckley.
You.
Mr. Chairman, let me be very concrete. For the last 12 years, I and a number of other people in New York City have sponsored a particular student in the Cardinal Hayes High School. The Cardinal Hayes High School is a parochial school, and it is selective in the following sense. They won't take any student who has both parents at home on the grounds that they can look after themselves. So all of them are single-parent children, and 95% of them are black and Hispanic. Now, those are students, or 85% of them go on to college, compared to their exact counterparts, 20% of whom go on to college. The cost of this high school training is $3,100 compared to $9,200 in the public schools. Why can't I continue to do that? Why can't the Cardinal Hayes High School receive the kind of backing that would make it possible to fill out their 1,000 vacancies? Now, extraordinary attitude towards religion catches my fancy. Mr. Glasser, of course, conceals the totality of the ACLU suspicion of anything that touches religion. For instance, they don't believe that chaplains should be paid for in the Congress. For all I know, they don't believe that chaplains should be paid for to help people who are about to be executed. On the other hand, they don't believe in executions either. It is another world. We had 1962, speak of the devil of denominational opportunism, a law, a prayer that was devised on behalf of the parents
by rabbis, Protestant ministers, and priests. They came up with a formulation that offended nobody. So they said, okay, that the programs would start every morning with the recitation of that simple prayer, knocked down by the Supreme Court. To what extent do we really believe that the Supreme Court was acting democratically in denying the sovereignty of the parents in that kind of situation? We speak of the great liberation, the putative liberation, as a result of the intervention of the court. Since 1962, there's been a 400% increase in crime, an 80% increase in the divorce rate, and a 310% interest increase in illegitimacy. I'm wondering whether we oughtn't to explore the possibility of a correlation. Do we really want to buttress ourselves in such a situation as to make it impossible in the schools to pass along that legacy which was acknowledged by all of our founding fathers?
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Well, I'm sure we can all agree that was a stimulating debate, and I'm sure we can all agree that most of us probably didn't change our minds while listening to it. Maybe some of us did. I have a solution. As I understand it, there was a study from Harvard that said one thing and a study from Princeton that said it something else. I think the solution is obvious, Mr. Buckley. There should be a study from Yale which should settle it, right? But pending that, I'd like to thank this National Center for Policy Analysis, Texas Christian University, Mr. Buckley, producer Warren Steibel, our audience here and our audience at home. Thanks very much and good night.
This program is a Warren Steibel production in association with South Carolina ETV. Funding for this Firing Line debate was made possible by grants from the John M. Olin Foundation, the Annenberg Foundation, the Hatton W. Sumners Foundation, and the Laurel Foundation. For a video cassette of this two-hour debate, send $49.50 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
For a transcript of this two-hour debate, send $10 to Firing Line, 2700 Cypress Street, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. State the subject of the debate and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.